Welcome to St. Mary's Harefield's streamed service for Sunday the 18th of September 2022, the 14th Sunday after Trinity, our Harvest Thanksgiving Sunday at St. Mary's Church. As the nation and the world prepares for the funeral of the Queen tomorrow, we will remember her throughout this Harvest Thanksgiving service, and particularly at the end. Harvest Thanksgiving in church became popular in the Victorian period, and our first hymn, Come Ye Thankful People Come, was written by the Victorian clergyman Henry Alford in 1844 as a good introduction to such a service. It invites us all to share in celebrating the harvest and thanking God for it. The hymn also focuses on life's spiritual harvest, where the wheat and the weeds are separated, and it looks forward to the day when the Lord our God shall come. Come, ye thankful people, come, raise the song of harvest home. Let us pray. The Collect for Harvest Thanksgiving. Creator God, you made the goodness of the land, the riches of the sea, and the rhythm of the seasons. As we thank you for the harvest, may we cherish and respect this planet and its peoples. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We also pray, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. If you'd like to get hold of a piece of bread and keep it until later, we can share it later in the service, very appropriate for a harvest service too. The Old Testament reading is Psalm 67. All people and nations are invited to praise God. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face shine upon us, so that your ways may be known upon earth, your salvation among all nations. May the peoples praise you, God. May all the peoples praise you. May the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you rule the peoples with equity and guide the nations of the earth. May the peoples praise you, God. May all the peoples praise you. The land yields its harvest. God, our God, blesses us. May God bless us still, so that all the ends of the earth will fear him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Israel has a very equitable climate, and all sorts of things grow there, so it often has some kind of harvest taking place. There are three main crops mentioned in the Bible as barley, wheat, and grapes, and they all lead to harvests at different times. Early in the season for barley, a bit later for wheat, and later again in the year for grapes. In an agricultural society, which is what we see in both Old and New Testaments, harvest is very important. The kind of society that we see lives a bit more hand-to-mouth than we're used to doing ourselves these days. A good harvest is joyfully celebrated because it means that people will be fed. A bad harvest may lead to starvation and is greatly lamented. A good or bad harvest is understood in biblical times as a measure of either God's blessing or otherwise, maybe God's judgment. Psalm 67, verse 6, the land yields its harvest. God, our God, blesses us. So today, we're all naturally concerned that we should be able to both eat and heat our homes in these challenging times. Considering the challenges that have been this year for the Harvest Festival and for the harvesting generally, including the very dry summer, it seems that harvests haven't been so bad. But the world situation with the war in Ukraine has reminded us of something that comes across in Psalm 67, that the world functions in an interdependent way. Ukraine's grain feeds a substantial number of people. When Russia turns off the gas tap, Europe significantly suffers. The world needs to eat, not just us. The world needs power to heat its homes, not just us. If harvests are bad elsewhere in the world, this will somehow affect us, and vice versa. It's helpfully informative for us to know where our food comes from. Why not make this an action point to find out when we buy things this month? It normally tells us on the packet in the supermarket. We might need to intentionally be more local in our supply and distribution of food. Think globally, but act locally. It's very important that we work towards more environmentally friendly and sustainable ways of producing everything, especially power, if planet Earth is going to be able to sustain the life it does in the future. Psalm 67, verses 4 to 5, may the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you rule the peoples with equity and guide the nations of the earth. May the peoples praise you, God. May all the peoples praise you. Psalm 67 is a psalm for the world, not just for one group of people. Today, the world is travelling to London for the Queen's funeral. Tomorrow, we'll be commemorating a monarch who greatly influenced the whole world. The world is big, yes, housing almost 8 billion people. But strangely, we often say the world's a small place. The phrase 6 degrees of separation is the idea that all people are six or fewer social connections away from each other. Psalm 67 is an encouragement to all peoples, to all nations, to revere God and to receive God's blessing. In practical terms, all people should be fed, have clean water, should be safe, valued, cared for, and loved. The war in Ukraine is a fracture in what should be the rock of international cooperation, It's a tear in the fabric of society. As long as it goes on, the more difficult it will be to build a world of harmony, where people are blessed, not bombed. I think we can safely say that imposing autocratic authority is not of God, and in the end simply doesn't work. We have to work together. Psalm 67, verse 7. May God bless us still, so that all the ends of the earth will fear him. At the end of Psalm 67, this is an interesting prayer. It prays for God's blessing upon Israel, that they might be a blessing to others. It echoes what is said at his establishment in Genesis 12:12. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. If we pray that kind of prayer, that we may be blessed in order to be a blessing, it means that the COVID-19 vaccines, which we've benefited from, are then given to the world to bless the world that doesn't have enough. If we have good harvests, then we share the benefits with those in the world who struggle. We are blessed in order to be a blessing. I think God likes that kind of prayer, and it's one we can help to answer ourselves. The hymn or song, Think of a World Without Any Flowers, was written by a music teacher, Doreen Newport, from Manchester. The words are evocative and invite us to think of what the world would be like if there weren't any flowers, any animals, or any love. God has created such a rich world, but we're very good at taking it all for granted and for destroying it to further our own ends. What a difference if we appreciate it, preserve it, and enhance it. Think of a world without any flowers. Think of a world without any trees. Today's Gospel reading comes from the Gospel of Mark. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. It's Mark chapter 4, verses 26 to 29, the parable of the growing seed. Jesus also said, This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces corn, first the stalk, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. As soon as the corn is ripe, he puts the sickle to it, because the harvest has come. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. This reading gives a picture of farming where someone scatters seed on the ground, then doesn't do anything really. The seed grows all by itself, and he reaps the harvest. It all sounds so simple and straightforward. No hard work, no buying of machinery, no hiring contractors, no ploughing, no fertilizing, no weed control, no pest control, no soil analysis, no marketing, no maintaining hedges, no promoting wildlife, no filling in forms for subsidy payment applications or this, that or the other. Just sow the seed and reap the harvest. It makes farming sound like a good job to apply for. But we know that farming is hard work, particularly in the present climate, in so many respects. It doesn't always pay off, and it doesn't always pay the bills. So what is this reading or parable all about? Well, it's saying something like, we can't give growth. We can only manage growth. Life and growth come from God, the divine, mysterious life force. Mark 4:28, all by itself the soil produces corn, first the stalk, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. Harvest Thanksgiving is a time to recognize that we need to be aware of and thankful for life and its provision. At the heart of farming lies a mystery, the mystery of growth. Seeds just grow, it's what they do. We may enhance the quality and quantity of growth in various ways and harness it more effectively. But this is just a little reminder that it's in the nature of a seed to grow. All we have to do is to let it grow. Gardeners know all about this kind of thing. This is the time to remember the most simple and at the same time the most profound things of life, to be thankful to God for the miracle of life, so grateful for all its provision, and to come to a place of acknowledging how dependent we are on God, the giver, sustainer, and grower of life. This little story is not really a story. It's put like this. The kingdom is like if a person did this. It's an entirely hypothetical scenario. It also refers to a lot more than a physical seed and an agricultural harvest. Just as a seed put in the ground doesn't seem to be growing, it actually is. The kingdom of God might not seem to be increasing in our world of sadness, violence, and uncertainty, but it is growing beneath the surface and bursts through in so many ways where goodness and love suddenly appear. Queen Elizabeth sowed many seeds of love, of the kingdom of God, of hope, service, and understanding. Her good life has by no means been lived in vain. So what does all this call forth from us? We can choose to sow seeds of love. We can choose to trust God to allow his seed to grow, his kingdom to expand, and to weave into our everyday lives good practices that will grow and bless others. There may be things to do, of course, but do we know what not to do? The Queen did. She couldn't speak politically, but she didn't need to in order to be effective. Her life had quality, not just quantity. We can be made to feel guilty if we're not working our socks off and chasing our tail. Mark 4:28, all by itself, the soil produces corn, first the stalk, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. The Greek philosopher Socrates is reported to have said, beware the barrenness of a busy life. So let's be the best we can be, as well as do the best we can do. As we watch the funeral of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth tomorrow, we might ask ourselves what legacy we are going to be leaving for others. Maya Angelou said, your legacy is what you do every day. It's every person you harm or help. That's what your legacy will be. The hymn, "We plough the fields and scatter," reminds us that farming very much involves hard work. It also involves being thankful to God, who is the best farmer there is. The hymn is of German origin, written by the poet Matthias Clodius in 1782. It was translated into English in 1861 and has become a firm favourite of harvest festival services ever since. We plough the fields and scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. As we turn to prayer, I'm going to light candles for Ukraine and for the Queen. You might notice that the altar frontal is actually purple, it's violet. This is a colour we often use for funerals and for death. And we are celebrating harvest. It's a strange dichotomy. It's an odd paradox today, as we're doing both things together. We remember the Queen, and we remember too the goodness of God and the flourishing of nature. So we pray that the Queen's funeral tomorrow will be an effective testimony to the lasting goodness of her life. Lord, help us to serve others in all that we do. We pray for the harvests throughout the world, that people would be able to be fed effectively in this growing population in our planet. Lord, help us to serve others in all that we do. We continue to pray for Ukraine as it uncovers mass graves and continues to bear the brunt of Russia's destructive violence. Lord, help us to serve others in all that we do. We continue to pray for the UK's new Prime Minister, Liz Truss, as she will need to begin her programme of governance in this coming week. Lord, help us to serve others in all that we do. We pray for the continuing situation caused by the flooding in Pakistan and the practical help it needs to survive. Lord, help us to serve others in all that we do. We pray for those who are ill. We remember Andrew Garner, baby Alexandra, Barbara Leek, Beryl Harold, Brenda Davis, Candy Hamlow, Carlene, Catherine Anderson, Eunice Haswell, Gareth Williams, Jill Pepperell, Gregory Ash, John Butler, Lewin, Mark, Neil, Neil Osgood, and any others we know. And we pray for those who grieve, for Queen Elizabeth II, for Pamela Humphreys, Ivan Oliver, Paula Heath, baby Henrietta Smith, and Claudia Blackstone, whose ashes are to be interred today. Let us confess our sins to God. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins, for the sake of your Son Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may share and serve you in the newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The hymn How Great Thou Art was written by Carl Boberg in Sweden as a poem in 1885. It was then translated into German, then Russian, then into English from the Russian by the English missionary Stuart Hine. Hine added two more verses of his own. And this great hymn reminds us of what a great world God has made, the one he loves and has redeemed. It became popular through Billy Graham's evangelistic crusades with George Beverly Shea and Cliff Barrows. Today it's become one of the most popular hymns of all time. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, how great thou art.
The mighty thunder.
So we come to that point in the service when we're going to share some bread together. If you would like to fetch a piece of bread on this harvest occasion, I'm going to fetch mine. So we need bread to live. We remember that. We also remember that we need more than bread to live. And God gives us everything we need. So we break this bread to remember so much about the goodness of life and the problems of life at this time of harvest thanksgiving. And as we do so and share our bread in our various places, we're going to hear a tune on the flute. Church is not actually open tomorrow, Monday, If you'd like to commemorate and watch the Queen's funeral service, you're welcome to come along to Harefield Social Club in the High Street. That's the building behind, the Legion building behind the Church Hall. Then you're very welcome to come. It's from 10 o'clock onwards. You can watch the service and there'll be a free buffet laid on too. So that's a possibility for you tomorrow. Tuesday is the third Tuesday lunch at the Church Hall at 12:30 p.m. You need to book with Sandra Mitchell if you'd like to come. It's always a great occasion and a very good lunch. There is a midweek service as usual this Wednesday at 10 o'clock in the Church Hall Chapel. And also on Wednesday is the Harefield Village Fellowship meeting at the Church Hall at 2 p.m. And Dawn Davis will speak on the joy of teaching. There's a small fee to pay for non-members. On Friday is the Harvest Supper, starting at 7 p.m. at the Church Hall. Do book in if you'd like to come. There's still availability. Just let the office know. And next Sunday, the services will be at the usual times here at St. Mary's, 8 o'clock Communion, and 10:30 Communion. And again, there'll be a streamed service at 10:30. The hymn Now Thank We All Our God was written by the German Lutheran pastor Martin Rinkart in 1636. This was in the middle of the 30 Years' War in Europe. Rinkart lived in the region of Eilenburg in Saxony, and the city became a bit of a refuge for political and military fugitives. But the result was it was overcrowded. There was lots of disease and famine. Armies overran it more than once, and the plague was very prevalent. So with a background of understanding, it's amazing that the words of this hymn are so positive. Great hymn of thankfulness to God, who from our mother's arms hath blessed us on our way. It was widely sung in Germany by the time of the Peace of Westphalia, which ended this war in 1648. And we still sing it with great meaning today. Now thank we all our God with hearts and hands and voices.
Thank you.
We end our service as usual with a poem. Now, Ukraine at the moment is a place of daily experience, death and violence. It's not the first place and it won't be the last to be in such a position. In the trenches of World War I, an army chaplain, Jeffrey Studer Kennedy, experienced himself an awful lot of death and violence every day. He wrote a poem for the men who were serving and who were experiencing all this. He didn't write it from a safe distance, but from the trenches, where he was himself. In 1914, at 31 years of age, he'd volunteered to serve on the front line and found himself here, in this difficult place. So this poem's a tribute to soldiers who, like Jesus of Nazareth, walked the path that led through pain to peace. And that's the important thing. That at the end of everything, including a great deal of pain sometimes, whatever might be causing that, there is peace. The Queen is at peace. People who've been suffering and struggling in life find at the end that they are at peace. So we pray for the people of Ukraine caught up in so much pain and loss right now. We pray they might find peace now and, of course, at the end. My peace I give unto you. G.A. Studer Kennedy, 1883 to 1929. Blessed are the eyes that see the things that you have seen. Blessed are the feet that walk the ways where you have been. Blessed are the eyes that see the agony of God. Blessed are the feet that tread the paths his feet have trod. Blessed are the souls that solve the paradox of pain and find that path that, piercing it, leads through to peace again. As we come to the end of our service, we remember the life of our Queen and we prepare to commend her to God tomorrow at her funeral service. So we end our service with a prayer, followed by an instrumental version of the national anthem played by the Coldstream Guards. A prayer in response to the death of Queen Elizabeth II on 8th of September 2022. Loving God, we give thanks for the long life of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, for her wisdom and dignity, her faithfulness to her vows, her dedication to public service, for her Christian faith and joyful witness. As we mourn her passing, we bring you our own sorrow and grief. We hold before you this nation which she loved so dearly and the wider Commonwealth so close to her heart. Especially at this time, we pray for her family, that you would strengthen and uphold each of them in their grief, especially tomorrow. We entrust Queen Elizabeth to your eternal love and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son Jesus Christ our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you today and always. Amen. The hymn Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah was sung at the Queen Mother's funeral service in 2002. It was also sung at a prayer and reflection service at Llandaff Cathedral in Cardiff on Friday, when Prince Charles visited Wales. The hymn was written in Welsh by William Williams of Pantycelyn in 1745. Williams was converted to Christianity by the preaching of Howell Harris in the 18th century Welsh revival. It was translated into English and eventually put to the tune Cwm Rhondda, composed much later in 1907 by John Hughes. It was also sung at the funeral of Diana, Princess of Wales, in 1997, and at William and Kate's wedding in 2011. It's a hymn that leads us forward rather than takes us back, an appropriate hymn to have as we end our service today. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land.